ज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई ऑफर माय नमस्कार टू माय गुरु हू एनलाइटन्ड मी एंड ब्रॉट मी आउट ऑफ द डार्कनेस ऑफ इग्नोरेंस बाय लिटिंग अप द हार्ट विद टॉर्च लाइट ऑफ स्पिरिचुअल विजडम. सो टुडे यू ऑल हैव अ कॉपी ऑफ दिस विद यू राइट नाउ. See, this is more than 150 pages, 146 pages. It will be practically impossible to complete this book in one session. But I will do something which will help you to gain a grasp of this subject today. And also, you will know how to use this book also. Recently, now, you can go to page, I'll tell you the page number. You can go to page 129 in the book. Like that, I will keep telling the page. When you refer, it will be easy for you. See, in page 129, appendix 4, the youth empowerment plan, through bring out the best in you courses, it's written. There are 10 courses. Each course has 10 books. This also is coming in the second course, if you see. In the second course, overcoming negative attitudes, this is the first book. In fact, this book is coming out of the printing press just now. You all are the first ones to get the book. It has just now come. Even I have not seen it. I am seeing it just now. So, this is the first book, 12 Tips to Convert Stress into Smile. So, like this, totally there are 100 booklets supposed to come. Two are out. This is the second book. And eventually, I want to bring out one book in a month. I have some materials ready. I am planning. So, now what is the highlight of this book? What are we going to talk in this? Now let us go to the contents page. Contents page is Roman letter 3, the beginning. The beginning? Beginning of the book. Leave the one page of the book and then go inside to contents. In this I will tell you what we will be doing today and what we will not do today. You know, like you see, there is a method to check whether you are under stress. If you want, you can move your neck and see like this. When you do like this, if you are getting some sounds, cracking sounds, we are under that much degree of stress. So there are various symptoms given there. And the second thing I'll be talking a little bit, scientific mechanism of stress generation. And also third one also, difference between threat and threat percept. And knowing personality type is very easy, that you can read yourself. Then the seventh one I'll be covering, there are 12 tips given there, ESEAP, each of them stands for a word, which you will learn today. And if you remember those 12 things, your life will become much easier and simpler. And you can easily, detect how the stress arises because of unawareness of this. This much only we will do. Rest of the book is available for you. You can go through it yourself at your leisure. And you can understand the book is pretty simple. I have prepared this book in such a way that activity sheets are inbuilt in it. Instead of giving photocopies to everybody, it's inbuilt in it. It's also a four-color book. There are many color pictures inside, you will see. And I have also written some skits. So we will read those couple of skits also. So the skits are written to make the subject matter interesting. So let us begin with the understanding of the stress. So whenever I tell you to turn to a certain page, you can turn and then we will read that section of it. And then when I'm speaking, you can keep the book down and then you can listen to me. So that we can grasp the subject. Although it's a pretty exhaustive subject, I have tried my best to make it as simple as possible. In the current day and age, this is a very hot topic. People are worried about the stress. So, a quick introduction about the stress. Our body is like a machine. It's like a machine. And Krishna himself says in Bhagavad Gita, Yantra Rudhani Mayaya. He says it's like a machine. Just as any machine has a certain capacity. Similarly, our body also has a physical capacity and we have mental capacity also. Say physically speaking, your body is very comfortable between 15 degrees centigrade to 25 degrees centigrade.
Mm.
Now, beyond that, if the temperature goes, you look above, is there a fan or is there an AC? You look for it. If temperature goes below 15 degrees, you are again uncomfortable. You are feeling very cold. You want to wrap a blanket around you. So you will see that you feel stressed when the temperature goes too low or too high, isn't it? This is your physical limits. Similarly, mental limit also, when you go to some unknown place or you see some different type of culture. Imagine somebody is from Punjab, they meet somebody from Karnataka. They may have, we're having different families, different cultures. Similarly, somebody from India goes to America first time. The cultures are different. So cultural shocks or cultural differences also bring about, like when you first saw me now, you'll be shocked. Who is this personality? We thought Radhesham, you might have probably not thought I'll be in this dress and shaven head. So you may get a culture shock. So in this way, when culture difference can cause some strain on the mind, in the same manner, somebody is insulting us, somebody is finding fault with us, or somebody says that we committed a mistake, or somebody neglects us. So these things cause problem to our mind. So then it causes strain in the mind, which we actually called as stress. Now, this stress is physically describable. It is described in this book physically, so that we can understand how it arises. So I will show you one picture, which if you see, it will become very easy to understand. See, come to page number 3. What I told you just now is in page number 3, paradigm of body and paradigm of mind. So now, from 4 onwards, you all know better than me on this subject. You see page number 4, work-related stress, urgency addiction, interpersonal conflict, multitasking, unrealistic targets, unhealthy competition, overexertion, irregular habits. So I am not going to speak on this, because this is something which you know from your workplace when you are working in a company. So these are different types of stress that comes on your system, body and mind, because of these different things. If you come to page 9, there is an activity there. So we will go one by one. You can say which of the ones are not conducive for reducing stress, which means which are stress producing, basically, which are stress producing. So beating deadline to get thrill, you should say yes, yes when you say, that means it's stress producing, okay? When you say no, it doesn't produce stress, okay? Beating deadline, no, you have no tension beating deadline. No, actually we should say yes means yes, there is stress in it. Yes, no? Correct. See, the very word beating shows that, you know, deadline is very close. Is it not true? Isn't it? Extraordinary achievements?
Yes.
Yes. Planning? Actually, planning need not involve stress if you are doing it well in advance. Actually, planning involves contemplation. Contemplation can, if you go to close to nature and you contemplate and do, it is a very enjoyable activity actually. Soft drinks in intervals? Yes, actually you may probably not know, inside the book you will find it elsewhere. Actually soft drinks and other things actually spoil our digestion. When digestion is spoiled, eventually it leads to stress. You will see that. Consuming salads, juices? Is it? Why it causes stress? It doesn't cause stress, yeah. Actually, we are talking about which causes stress. When it causes stress, you say yes. Eating an hour before midnight?
Yes.
Yes. Why? Even when I was in IIT days, we used to go to Woodlands Hotel inside the campus. So we used to eat at 12 o'clock at night. Some friends used to take us. And we never knew how bad it is. So they said, there are doctors say that eating like that at midnight leads to indigestion. Indigestion leads to stress. Ambition? Ambition doesn't cause stress. Over-ambition causes stress. Like for example, you can drive the Maruti at 80 km per hour. But if you are driving Maruti at 120 km per hour, that is very dangerous. It will spoil the vehicle. And eating fast food, yes, that also causes stress, as I told you. Fast food is called fast food, but it digests very slowly. Because it's made of maida. White flour. Awareness of our capacity. No, it doesn't cause stress. Because once you know your capacity and act accordingly, then you can avoid stress. Like for example, most people are unaware of their capacity. Therefore, they tend to overload themselves. They get fatigue, we call it. You know fatigue? Fatigue means extreme tiredness. If any of you feel that working in the office sometimes is causing you dozing, or sometimes you are feeling tiredness, extreme tiredness, that is due to overload. And fatigue-driven errors also, we say. Fatigue leads to errors also. And another one, moroseness from unmet expectations. Yes, it causes stress. Hyperactive mind, definitely. And leadership. Actually, leadership, what type of leadership you do, it depends on that. Actually, leader versus manager, if you see, if you are a visionary leader, you know how to lead like playing games very joyfully. True leadership is like that. An attachment to opinion? Yes. Eating only after finishing work? Yes. Some people say, unless I finish my work, they even skip the lunch, they throw away the watch and forget the lunch box. So that causes stress also. Expectations? Actually, there are two types of expectations. One is called unrealistic expectations. That causes stress. Otherwise, as a boss, who said you cannot have expectation? Otherwise, how will the company run? Some expectations are there, but when we have unmet, or we can say that unrealistic expectations, which makes us become upset, they cause stress. An organizing table, that means, you know, a place for everything and everything in its place. Does it cause stress? No. Charisma and influence. Now you only, yourself. Say for you to, in English there is a word called clout, we say, no? And to maintain your clout, to maintain your charisma and influence over people, does it cause stress? It does cause stress. It causes stress in your mind. Imagine you are going to some place, everybody is clicking you, click, 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 they are clicking photos. And then everybody is surrounding you, big crowd of people. It causes the prestige stress. Stress arising from prestige. Like many cinema actors and actresses say that they face terrible problems because of this. Shame of being low performer.
Yes.
Undue competition.
Yes.
Courage. No. So if you tilt the book upside down, you will see the answers. Items not to be encircled are, it's given here, extraordinary achievements. Actually, here it says, extraordinary achievements is also included in this. Why? Because somebody has achieved extraordinary achievements and is satisfied in his position, gets a sense of accomplishment, he can be peaceful also. Planning, consuming salads, ambition, awareness of our capacity, leadership and expectation, organizing people, charisma and influence. And charisma and influence is written here. Why? People with charisma and influence feel deep sense of satisfaction also, provided they are situated in their core character. There are people also who, great leaders of charisma and influence, and they have a sense of achievement and they can be peaceful. They cannot be peaceful and they can be stressed only when you read the book, you will understand when they will be stressed. And courage. So this was one activity. Now you go to next page, page number 10. You see a lion chasing a zebra. You are seeing that picture? So the doctors have found out that when is the stress generated? For example, this animal is running behind a zebra. So here there are a few things given. This is actually called fight or flight, we call it. We all are subjected to fight or flight situation in life. Like you have to fight the deadline to cover it, isn't it? And you have to go for a flight away from failure, isn't it? Flight means flee away. Fight means attack. Now why this example is given here, if you see just above the picture I have explained there, when the animal is chasing, the pupils dilate, animal sees better and hearing becomes more acute, heart beats faster, blood pressure rises and breathing becomes more rapid and all that. But after capturing the prey, the tiger or lion becomes peaceful because now no more running. And another example I have given here, you see the chain snatcher is snatching. So actually this is the only picture we got. Actually the story says this Lata, she was actually going in a train in a ladies compartment, nobody was there. She was only there and one man got into the bogie and showed a knife trying to snatch her chain. Somehow she had the guts, she had a suitcase with her, she hit him on the head several times and kicked him on his chest and he fell down. She snatched the knife also from him. Must be a courageous Lata, courageous lady. So by the time next station came, she screamed, thief, thief, and all the people thrashed that fellow. Next station. Now try to put yourself in Lata's situation. You know, her mental state, which was peaceful before, as soon as that fellow showed the knife and the snatching of the chain, do you agree that she went to a very excited and stressed level? Now when does that stressed, excited state from there, she returns back to normal? After the people have captured that fellow and, you know, taken to police. And now so at this time you will see, she must have been breathing heavily. Her eyes will be dilated to make sure that the fellow doesn't kill her. The pupils dilate, the heart is breathing very fastly. And the blood rushes to the ends of the hands and legs for her to get strength to take the suitcase and hit him. So the blood which is supposed to go to stomach for the digestive process, that goes to the ends of the hands and legs. So that there's and who is doing it? The mind is doing it. Because the mind knows there is a danger now. Let the blood be supplied to the end of the hand so that we can, you know, attack the person and things like that. And once she comes back to normal, again she is all right. So have you all heard about two types of hormones, adrenaline and endorphin? Endorphins are hormones which secrete when you are happy, when you are jolly, they secrete. And adrenaline secretes when you are in a stress situation or tension situation. So everybody would like to have which hormone naturally? Endorphins. Of course, we are always joyful, always you have endorphins. But the adrenaline hormone secretes when you are suddenly subjected to a threatening situation, a dangerous situation. But the doctors say, we have a doctor also, doctors say that the adrenaline causes the blood vessels to choke, it causes increase of blood pressure. It increases the blood pressure and that leads to heart attack and such kinds of problems. And also, the medulla oblongata, which is behind portion, there is a, what do you call it, endocrine glands you call it, correct? No, endocrine orchestra they call it, which means the emotions. So therefore you get a stiff neck whenever you get stressed. You know, I told you, when you move like this, you just try whether you are getting a sound, you can check it. If you are getting sound, some people are afraid to test themselves because a big sound is going to come. They will try out when they are alone. So none of us want to be stressed in our lives. But as I told you, the adrenaline actually causes stress. Now Lata, she physically acted and everything comes normal, see. Now I have given another story of one Mr. Sushil working for a toothpaste company. He is close to 50 years of age. So this fellow suddenly, the company sees some failures and everything. So they change the MD at the top. And when that fellow, when the MD comes, he's an aggressive tycoon. He wants to get the work done. But Sushil has been a happy-go-lucky guy. From morning 9 to 5, coolly coming and going, doing little work. But now the new guy comes and he is hiring and firing people. So he is calling Sushil and tells him in no uncertain terms. He is telling him, see, you have been, you know, somehow coasting along and not doing much. Now it is time for you to prove yourself. And you will have to stay till night, 9 o'clock. and this is the result I'm expecting from you. And then he is saying 1, 2, 3, 4, many, many things he is telling. Now when Sushil comes back to his seat, you know, he's sitting in his cabin and is profusely sweating. Why is he sweating now? Because he's fearful. You know, I may be fired from the job. And he's very angry with this new boss also. He feels that he is too demanding. He has too much expectation from me. But now what happens? The adrenaline is secreting. And at the same time, now the body has to act. Can he punch the boss on his nose? He can't do that. If he does it, he'll be out of the job. Is it not true? So there is no physical action. So therefore what happens? The blood is secreted. It goes to the hands and legs. At the same time, what happens? The tension of Mr. Sushil is an ongoing tension because there is no clear end result of this. So will he be thrown out of the job? You all have to say yes or no. Will he be thrown out of the job? Okay, some of them said no. And some of them said yes. Okay, will he be allowed to stay in the job forever? You are sure? Who knows? He may actually improve his performance and he may stay in the job. He may continue also, no? So these questions are questions which do not have the answer yes or no. They are the ones which cause us stress. For example, you are joining a company. Was at the company, when I was in Seattle, one boy was driving me from Microsoft. He was telling, the last 5% of the people are chucked out every year. They are given pink slip and shown the door. The top 5% people are promoted and given increment in salary. So he was telling me that nobody wants to be in the last 5% in the company. But in case they are low performers, they are likely to be, you know, removed from the company. So do you agree that the persons who are close to the last 5%, they will be leading a stressful life? Do you agree? Because they do not know whether they will be removed or not. Similarly, imagine a boy writes an examination. It's a competitive exam. And then he is awaiting the results now. So that period of time when he is awaiting results, his mind is under stress. Is that clear to everybody? And now, see, I am putting a background for you, then you will appreciate the mechanism. Now let's go to the mechanism directly. I will tell you one page number. You can come to page number 16. See the picture below in page number 16. How stress is created in the mind. You see some stimuli is given using sound or sight or gesture like that on our intelligence. If the intelligence knows what is that stimuli, then there is no stress. But if it does not know what is the stimuli, it's unknown. So the negative red is given and stress is generated in the mind to take corrective action. Now the mind becomes very worried. So it wants to take corrective action. If corrective action is taken, no stress. If corrective action couldn't be taken, stress. For example, say you are walking in the road in the night. Suddenly in the dim light, you are thinking something about home and everything. Suddenly you find a snake crossing the road. And as soon as you see the snake, what happens? Stress is created in your system. Immediately the blood flows from your, you know, from the heart. Instead of going to belly, it goes to the hands. And legs, you get alarmed. It's a real problem. You are watching the snake and you know that it has to be killed. See, if it is on the road, maybe we will think that I will not kill the snake, I will run away or something. But imagine if a snake comes to our home or just near the home, we will want to kill it, isn't it? Then immediately you take a stick and hit the snake and make sure you crush the head of the snake. It is dead now, fully dead. You burn it away. Then you will feel that then you will not feel any more stress. Correct, no? So, now when you are looking at the snake, it appears, whether it is a snake or a rope, you don't know. The rope is like this, for example. It looks like a snake. Would you like to try putting your feet on it? You won't do it, isn't it? But you want to be sure whether is it a rope or a snake, especially in a dim light, you cannot know it. So, if you don't know, is stress produced or not? Yeah, because your mind is not able to know. And then you tell somebody, hey, bring a torch. Take a stick and do like this, then you find it is only the rope that you had put for putting the clothes in a cloth line that has fallen down. There is nothing to worry. Then the mind knows it is not a snake. So mind has no more stress. If the mind knows the answer, it has no more stress. Or if the mind knows there's a real threat, then the mind will want the senses to take action. Is that clear? Yeah. So there are two words used in this booklet called threat and threat percept. Threat percept means perceived threat. It's not real threat. Okay, in case, for example, this rope, this wire now looks like a snake. I put on the light, I know it's wire. So no more fear. Correct? No? Because mind knows the answer. It's no more threat now. But in case, in a dim light, if this appears like a like this kind of rope, I think it may be a snake, then it is a perceived threat. Correct? No? Perceived threat means I imagine that there is a threat. Actually, there is no threat with this. So here is the secret of stress management subject. Whatever you all in your lives you think as something that is perceived by your mind as threat, you are going to certainly fear it. And that is the root cause of stress. Some examples when you see it will become very easy for you. See. Okay, come to page number 14. There is an activity here. See, two of you, you can talk to your neighbor. And what you have to do, there are five situations I have given here. You should say how you would respond. We all know very well how generally people respond for these five. But you have to give an alternative idea how else we can respond. Is that clear? Like for example, this is one jam people don't like. Which is the jam they don't like? Mango jam or apple jam? Traffic jam, isn't it? So, in case you are caught in a traffic jam while driving in a rush hour, in Pune we have seen it ourselves, experience. So, what are different things you can do? Say you are standing at a signal for many minutes. So, you can give alternatives. So, you all discuss with your friends and then I will ask you, all the five you discuss. Okay. All the five you discuss and then keep answers ready with you. I will give one chance to one of you. So you all got an idea? Okay. I want only one of you to answer. Who would like to answer the first one? Anybody? One of you please raise the hand. If you're caught in a traffic jam while driving in a rush hour, practically you have stopped the vehicle. What would you like to do? Yeah. Your good name?
My name is Aniket.
Yes, Aniket.
Nothing. I'll just turn on the music.
Yeah.
Nothing else I can do.
Just relax. Yeah. Yeah? That's what
it happens a lot of times. So yeah. Just turn on the music and stay calm. That's it.
Yeah. And there is no use throwing tantrums on the person ahead of us. because nothing can, you know.
You can't move the other vehicles.
Yeah, we can't. Anybody has any other idea you would do? Yeah, yes, madam.
Someone with whom we have not been able to talk for a long
time. That's a good time to utilize for phone calls. Instead of them wasting our time in the office. Okay, very good. Very intelligent. So in this way, we can know how to utilize the time fruitfully. Correct, no? Yeah. Second one, getting a last minute work assignment. Anybody? Anybody got it? And I would like to know how you responded. Anybody?
You would probably flip about it for a while and then ultimately work.
So we crib, you crib for a while and then you ultimately do the work, isn't it?
To release the stress, maybe crib with your friends or something.
Yeah. So when we get a last minute assignment, our mind is not prepared. Although we do the work, mind really complains. Why are you always doing this to me? You know, why don't you give it to someone else? You always catch me. And why didn't you tell me yesterday or whatever? So like she said, that is the first response of our mind naturally. And over a period of time, if you knew that your boss is always, you know, having that habit of giving last minute assignment, you will get used to it eventually. You know that this is how life is going to be. Is it not true? Most important thing is we shouldn't become reactive, overly reactive. Like you see, third one, misplacing some important piece of information. What you would do, anybody? Anybody else? You know, sometimes people pound on the table. They throw things. They kick the chair or something like that. Or they shout, oh, like shout loudly. And I'm not able to locate that. These are responses we all have experienced, we have done sometime or other. How else would you do? How else would you respond? Misplacing some important piece of information. And the most amazing thing is, like, you know, one man, you know, while talking to somebody, he just did his specs like this. And then later on, he had to go to office. He wanted the specs. He searched everywhere in the room. He couldn't find it. And when he was shouting his, you know, friend came from the next room and said, hey, what happened to you? You've gone crazy. What? Nobody is in the room. And then he said, my specs is missing. He said, it's here, he said. Isn't it? So sometimes the thing is so near you, but due to our anger, we are not able to spot it out. So therefore, what would you do? Anybody? If you misplace some important information?
Can you sit down for a while in peace and try to, in our mind, rethink we have kept it.
Yes. Actually, when you do something else and come back, you will find it. There are many other things to do also. We don't have to become obsessed with it. Unless I find it, I'm not going to give it up. We don't have to be like that. Okay, having something break while using it. Oh, really?
I'll get that break for myself in that working
hours. See, the other day I was coming in a car. I was working in my laptop. Of course, mine is Apple laptop. It slipped and, you know, fell in the side only. Not outside the car, inside the car only. I was shocked. My assistant was smiling. I asked, hey, you are smiling? I'm dropping it on the ground. He said, Prabhu, it is Apple, you know, computers are made of metallic, this thing, he said. You don't have to worry. What do you call it?
No, I
don't worry, yeah. He said it is pretty safe. Similarly, he said, mobiles are also nowadays made with some kind of glass. They don't break very easily, he said. I said, that doesn't mean we have to purposefully throw it down. But sometimes it does happen that things slip out from our hands. So what to do? You know, Baba Rajendra Prasad, one of his servants, 2 times broke flower vases. But he was a very loyal servant who worked with him more than 20 years faithfully. So Baba Rajendra Prasad was so angry, he told him that I want to throw you out of the job. So the servant went outside the house and sitting outside sobbing. Then when he went out and saw this fellow sobbing, he called him in and accepted him, which means he forgave him. So in our life also, if somebody breaks a glass, we will become wild on them. But the glass may be only 2 rupees or 5 rupees. But our becoming wild on them may ruin the relationship may break, isn't it? So therefore, as one of you rightly said, we have to know how costly the thing is when it breaks also, isn't it? So one shouldn't make a mole into a mountain. Therefore, this type of attitude we have to develop. something breaks while using it, what can be done? You can't reassemble it immediately. So therefore, we have to tell ourselves, stay calm, be peaceful. Now you can't rectify it immediately. What cannot be cured must be endured, it is said. And the fifth one, being blamed or insulted for something, this is the most painful thing. Somebody is pointing fingers at me and, you know, we feel extremely vulnerable in our mind. What do you think we should do if somebody is doing that for us? We become very upset with them. We sometimes may call them names, or sometimes we may do backbiting behind them. You know, we may sweet talk on face and bad mouth on back in case somebody points fingers and gives us a feedback. It's very painful. Anybody? What can you alternatively do? If somebody is blaming you for something or insulting you for something.
Maybe we can...
You can give one more opportunity to others.
Yeah,
you answered two questions very nicely. Anybody else would like to answer? Anybody? It's a little difficult question, I think.
If we react immediately, and will the blame will come again. The front person will again will start shouting
more
loudly. And if we stay calm and we go beside him, he will don't... stop and stop shouting on us.
Okay.
And start listening.
So he says that we will stay calm. Okay, we can try our best to do that. Anybody else has an answer? Yes, Prabhu. Oh, Prabhu, I want to give chance to the newcomers. Yes, anybody? They have come for the first time, some of them. Anybody want to try? You see, when somebody blames me, I can find out, is there any element of truth in what he is saying? Isn't it? Why? Like if somebody says, hey, you are always slow to complete the things. You told me that you will make it ready by 3 o'clock. Now it is 6 o'clock, you haven't done it. Is it true or not? First we can check it. And you look at the clock, yeah, I told 3 o'clock, now it is 6. What he's saying is true. Then why should I become angry? There is an element of truth in what he's saying. And I know I am slow. So we can say, sorry, sir, I am a little slow. And you are kindly tolerating me. Next time I'll try to be more faster, we can say. So therefore, and there is another course called Art of Smart Work. There it is taught how we should cultivate sattva guna, we call it. Sattva guna means, you know, thinking before speaking. And not just making a hasty dash. So then we will be able to speak properly. So these are all situations where we may overreact. And by overreacting, we cause stress to ourselves and we cause stress to others also. And we create a very stressful situation. Now come to the next page, 16. In page 16, I have given this threat and perceived threat. See, I have given in green color three statements, you see. Suddenly you find a snake at night in your room, or doctor says that you have to undergo bypass surgery, or there's a fire breakout in the kitchen. So these are all real problems, correct, no? These are not imagined problems. These are real problems. And you have to take a swift action for all this. Your mind is very disturbed by seeing a fire in the kitchen, or, you know, doctor saying you have some big disease or something like that. It's a real problem. But then there are perceived problems given in the next page. See those green ones. Someone disagreed with your opinion. Someone failed to offer you respects. So these are all examples of imagined problems. For example, when one gets less marks in the examination or something, you know, you are not so much worried about the less marks, you are worried about what others will think of me. Correct, no? Parents and the image that is created, that kind of problem, isn't it? Okay, there is an activity in page 18, next page. Next page, go to next page. Somebody can read the first activity. You have to give two answers, one threat answer and perceived threat answer. Somebody read the first one loudly, give the mic to them. What's the mic? Yeah. Can you please read it? First one? Yeah. Yeah. So he will read the problem and then you all can write the answers. You can tell the answer. Yeah.
So you hear a loud noise outside the window. You are curious.
Like this,
to
just
know.
Now we heard the noise now. Yeah.
So you are curious to know what has happened.
Imagine just outside the window, a big sound comes. So you can write what can be a real threat you all can think about and what can be a perceived threat. Okay? What could be a real threat? It's like a detonation sound comes. Pat! Like that sound comes. What it could be? That is actually, yeah, it's a perceived threat. Correct, no? Perceived threat means when a tire bursted, so you peeped through the window and saw one for a scooter tire bursted because of the hot sun or whatever. Then he starts towing the scooter. And then what was seen as a danger turned into amusement for you. Correct, no? Is it not true? What could be a real threat when you hear such a sound? There could be accident or it could be bomb blast. Yeah, there could be some real terrorists. That is possible. Similarly, the next one, please read the second one.
Your subordinate does not wish you good morning one day. You are enraged.
Yeah, isn't it? So what could be a real threat or what could be perceived threat? Anybody would like to answer? Yes.
Yes.
He doesn't consider himself your subordinate anymore.
So one could be like he might be in some other thought at that time, so he might forget to wish you.
That is perceived threat. That means actually respects you, but it appeared that he is not respecting you. That is perceived threat. Then later on, you understand that he comes and talks to you very normally. There's no danger. But what could be a real threat? That when you are going in the morning, he looks at you, turns his face away, like that. So then what could be the real threat? Anybody? He's upset about your something that you did yesterday or said yesterday. So you can go to him and ask in a friendly mood, how do you do, good morning? And then if he says, you know, I am in no mood to talk to you today, you know, you did this or you said that, if he says, then he opens up, correct, no? So that is a real threat actually, because it's a threat to your relationship, like that. Now you all understand this, threat and real threat. So I have given a skit here. I need two people, Shyam and Ram I need. See the page number 19 below. When someone ignores us, what should we do? Two of you, two mics are available? Give them two mics. Who would like to play the role? Two of you? Give two mics, yes. So you alternatively you both will speak, okay? One for Shyam, one for Ram. Yeah. Okay.
I'll play Ram.
Yeah.
You look morose, Ram, today. Anything unpleasant happened?
I just cannot understand why our boss forgot to mention my name in yesterday on anniversary meet announcements. I think he is envious of me.
Oh, you're upset about that. Do you remember you were changed from our team to another team 6 months ago?
But what about the good work I did in the first 6 months? At least people should have some courtesy for someone who contributed to the early phase of the work.
I understand, Ram, but probably you may not know, we changed the whole direction of the project after 6 months due to the market situation. Therefore, everybody had to embark on a new direction and had to work very hard to complete the whole work within the next 6 months.
Really? Nobody told me about that, as I was already shifted by our boss to another project.
Yes, in fact, our boss had a plan to request the management to put you back with him. Since he considers you as a powerful idea generator, he has several times told me this.
That's the news for me, Shyam. I just had a totally opposite idea about him, and I've been spreading the word around that he is jealous of me, doing wonders in other project.
That's far from truth, Ram. Maybe you will see for yourself about his appreciation for you when you meet him personally.
I wonder why I behaved in such a bad way, mouthing him out behind his back. It wasn't appropriate, Shyam.
When we don't get due respect, we feel threatened, unwanted and neglected. Did you feel that?
Yes, precisely. That was the reason I had to speak ill of a boss. What would you do, Shyam, if you were in my situation?
I would want to know the truth from our boss, and therefore I would meet him personally to know more about what happened with the project and and that would help me know what is true instead of talking with others. Also, Ram, I feel in this world everybody has the right to respect us or neglect us, and thus we come across people who are friendly with us, neutral to us and averse to us. We can't all the time get put off by those who are unfriendly with us. because that will lead us, that will lead to stress. Also, sometimes, as it happened in your case, we may imagine that somebody like our boss is unfriendly with us based on some incident. While he may not be unfriendly at all, this is simply figment of our mind's imagination.
That's true. Then how do we counteract that stress till we come to know of the truth?
We can avoid taking it emotionally. Instead, we can find the essence of the element of truth in it. Also, we all experience pleasure and pain both in this world. Sometimes we get pleasure, other times we get pain. It's like the day and night, summer and winter, victory and defeat. We should go on with our life, doing the right thing, leaving it to God. In this world, all humans have the four defects of imperfect senses: to be illusioned, to commit mistakes, and to cheat. Due to this, they gather wrong perceptions about other living beings. We can try to clarify, but we can't force anyone. As far as we are concerned, we see everybody as God's child and treat them warmly in a friendly manner. Thus, we can be free from stress.
That's a great understanding, Shyam. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So, you all understood this? It's a very easy to grasp skit. So, one of the questions for you. In this, what was the mistake that Ram did? Who can say? Please give the mic behind.
Assuming about the perception or situation, what he would have asked.
Assuming about the boss's intentions, which he was unaware. So he assumed that his boss was envious of him. That is his own perception. So that is it threat or is it perceived threat? Perceived threat. So in this world, we have many perceived enemies. They are actually not our enemies. Sometimes you find one of your friends comes to the company, he doesn't talk to you. You think, hey, he doesn't talk to me. Maybe he has some problem with me. But he is preoccupied in his mind with his own project. He is worrying about it. So many times we have perceived enemies or perceived threat. So one lesson we learned in this skit, anybody can say, after hearing the Ram Shyam dialogue? Any important lesson that you learned for your life from this? Anybody else? Oh, you answered one question nicely. I want someone else to answer also. Anybody else? Any one good lesson? How many of you feel this skit was easy for you to grasp? You understood the content well. Okay. So what one lesson you learned from this?
Do not have wrong perceptions.
Okay, one is do not have wrong perceptions about others. Okay. Have open communication with anybody. Don't hold any assumptions. Okay. One more very important lesson I am looking for. Hold for a while before you arrive at conclusion. Don't go to sweeping conclusions. Okay. Anybody else? Okay, good, very good. She went one step ahead. She is saying that we think we know everything. We can always wait to watch for a while, ask someone, and before coming to our conclusions ourselves, because we may not be all-knowing. We are not God to be all-knowing. So we can wait. That is also a good lesson. But I am looking for some another lesson, very important lesson. That was the lesson. One applause you give for him. Yeah, very good. Try not to react instantly. Whenever you are put to situation, think twice before you act. That's one lesson we learn. And also don't bad mouth about anybody. Imagine if you bad mouth about your boss, and if boss comes to know, you can be in trouble. Isn't it? So it's better for us not to bad mouth about anybody. That's another lesson we learn. As you said, do not react or do not overreact. So it is better to think before reacting, because now you all have understood a very important lesson today, which is about perceived threat. So in your life, in your daily life, you can see what are the threats that I'm imagining in my life unnecessarily. So that is one thing you learn. Thank you. when you go to page number 25, in page 25, see, I have given situations which cause threat percept nowadays. Like job, when you are in a job, you are fearful that I may be laid off, company may go on strike, I may commit some mistakes and all that type of fear. Similarly, in finance also, Like one boy asked me, sir, should I put money in the Cosmos Bank or in the government bank? I told him, see, I'm not very familiar with all this. You decide, I told him. He said, no, whatever you say, I will do. In those days, many years ago. I said, then he told me, see, government bank gives 6-7% only. The Cosmos Bank gives some 24%. Then I said, okay, put it in Cosmos Bank, you get 24%. He said, but the problem is such private banks may go diwala anytime, bankrupt. Then I said, okay, then put in the government bank. The only problem is they give only 7%, they give, you know. He said, and then I said, okay, put half here, half there. Then he said, see, this half I will get 24%, but that other half I will get only 7%. What to do? I said, I know. Because of answering a question, I'm head is shaved now. All my hair is gone now. So, in this way, some people can subject you to stress by asking such questions. You understand now? Therefore, he's saying these things have no concrete answer. That means any problem in your life which does not have a concrete answer is a potential stress creator. Like right now, your job security, you all are very young now. So when our job security is not very strong, there is a moment of stress in the head, correct now? And in case you have worked for 15, 20 years and you are in a very leading position and you know, you are very much wanted by the company, depends on you, then you may not be under stress. But otherwise, there is always a fear of, you know, the job. Similarly in relationships also, in Vedic times, when a girl was given by the parents, in South India, for example, I had three sisters, when they were all getting married, once I asked my father, why on the marriage day, in South India, they have this Nadaswaram, they call it, long one, you know, and then they have this, mridangam, melam type of thing. So when my sister, my elder sister was getting married, they are putting the Mangalsutra around the neck, you know. That time they will play this very loud. Dum, 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 dum. They'll play, pee, 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 they will play like that. I asked my father, what is the significance? He said, sometimes in marriages, they say, we will give you this much dowry, or the girl doesn't know how to cook, but they say she only cooked everything. Such lies they say. But last minute during the Mangalsutra time, you play it so loudly that even if somebody talks, that will get doused completely. Marriage will happen. And it is considered that you give the girl in marriage, problem solved. But in this day and age, even after giving a daughter in marriage, you can't be peaceful. Because sometimes the boy and girl, when they are living in a nuclear family, you know, in cities, they don't have any elders to guide them. They quarrel like cat and rat, and then she comes back home. Sometimes it ends up in a divorce also, correct? No? Therefore, the relationship is said, the relationships are also very delicate. In case a husband and wife relationship is not very good, or a boss and subordinate relationship is not very good in a company, or a friend and friend relationship is slightly strained, that also causes stress. It causes stress. Like right now, say you are going to company. Yesterday only you had a little tussle with your boss. While going to company, what comes in your mind? This fellow yesterday, I am not going to leave him. You know, just because he's my boss, you know, he thinks he can shout at me, I can also shout back. Like that, the mind starts giving running commentary. Correct, no? Similarly, a man is returning home in the evening. In case he had a pleasant exchange with wife in the morning, he will happily return home. But he had a little strenuous exchange in the morning. He feels, why should I go home at 7 o'clock? Better I reach at 10 o'clock and go to sleep. By the day he feels. So in this way, these are all things. That means whichever problem is in your mind which does not have a solution, yes or no solution, that causes threat. Is that clear to everybody? Yeah. So one thing which I am not going to do today is this, page number 25 below. If you see a practical case study of Mr. Sushil, you can read it leisurely later on. See, there are 5 steps given there. Is my problem real or imaginary? First you should check it, and then record your emotions. That is important to see the tabular column. Like this you can see, landscape mode. The tabular column, if you see, this is where we can make record in our life. Whenever you are feeling stress in your life. You see the 11 a.m. is the timing. What happened? One customer came with a complaint. At that time, I erupted. I became upset or angry with him. And then what was the emotion? First I restrained and eventually I became angry. You are seeing it here? Huh? And the stress level was high or low. In case you felt very high, you write high. And then avoidance tactics means what mistake you did because of which the customer was angry. The records were not good. So organize records better. That's a solution here. Similarly, Monday, same day, 2 p.m. See, same day, one more case. Computer crashed. And 1 hour of work was lost, which you have been doing. Which means we, what was the mistake while working in the computer? 1 hour of work is lost means, what was the mistake? I did not save it. So that's what is written in the last column. Save work regularly and keep backup. So because I didn't save, I got frustration, anger on myself. I didn't become angry on someone else. I became angry on myself. So how many of you feel it's easy to understand this table? Is it easy for you? So I have left two more, which if you want, you can fill up at your leisure. In case you feel stress anytime, this is the way we have to make it. You can...
One minute, just one announcement.
Yes.
There is a van parked MH12QM4991. It is parked in someone else's parking and the owner is asking us to take it out. So do you know if it is someone from our group? No, QM... 4991.
Okay. So, yeah, there are 6 steps given here, which you all can apply. Second one was recording emotion. Third one was reframing. Reframing means seeing positively. And fourth one is analyzing precise cause of stress. And then how to write down the adverse consequences and hoping for the best, be prepared for the worst. These are actually 6 steps involved in solving any stress-related problem. It's not very difficult. You can do it yourself. And I am also not going to do that page 31. Type A or type B personality, you can read it yourself. That is also important. Leisurely, you can read it. Type A people are very passionate people, are very leaders who are workaholics. And type B is actually wanted. A cool-headed and creative manager is type B. And coming to page number... I'll tell you the page number. See, in page number 45, okay, page number 42 you can take. Page number 42. Page number 42, see, I have given to avoid stress in our life, there are 4 things given there. The picture is given there. Work-life balance and regulation in habits, isn't it? For example, if you do yogasanas, if you do pranayama, if you eat at proper times, if you don't eat at any time of the day, many people eat this junk food, or they eat potato chips, or they take cold drinks, they take food from the fridge. So, some of you might have read Ayurvedic booklets and all. Nowadays, a lot of awareness is created worldwide. You should know what to eat and what not to eat. It's very important. So, eating, relaxing, resting and exercising. These 4 things are very important. Eating is diet. And exercising, doing yoga, asanas and everything, jogging, acrobic exercise and all that. And also sleeping well, 6 hours of sleep, proper sleep. Sleeping doesn't mean lying down and closing eyes. That is not sleeping. Just like computer also sometimes, imagine 20 files are open in your computer. And you just close the computer, next day morning you touch it, it is like a tawa which is very hot. You've seen the computer, it happens. Because files are open and you not shut it down properly. Similarly, when you lie down in the night, sometimes mind is making a lot of plans, dreams. So the files are open still. So your body is not well rested. You can see that. So therefore, we should be able to get good sleep. I have given more information about it. Eating proper food, sleeping properly, exercising properly and relaxing properly. So all those things have to be done. Then one is considered a good animal. Can you imagine? Why? Because if you take care of only the body, one is considered good animal. But then if you are good in your learning, learning doesn't mean cramming and vomiting. Intellectual need, IQ, which is mentioned, that actually means one understands and learns. Then you are a good craftsman. Like nowadays, in whichever field you are to keep abreast of the world. Then you are considered a good craftsman. Similarly, if you know very well that money is not everything, you know, just a position and prestige in society is not everything. I need relationship. Some people are very good in caring for wife, children, mother, father, everybody. They are called as a good friend. But if somebody can connect with God through prayer and devotion, then he's called as a good saint. All the four things put together makes you a complete human being. Therefore, the picture gives all the four. Correct, no? Page number 42, I have given the picture. So, now come to page 45. I am giving a very important information here. In page 45, there is a blue color picture. You saw that? In page 45. See, the real you is the Atma, which you see in the yellow color. Above the yellow color, there is a dot, dot, dot. And that is our mind, intelligence and ego. And outside that, there is a white color outer covering. That is the gross body. I have given the example of a computer there, you see. Computer is a hardware. That is our outer body is like a computer hardware. Okay? And inside that hardware, you find the dot, dot, dot picture. That is actually considered to the subtle body. That means the mind is the hard disk. Intelligence is the decision maker, correct? It's a CPU. Then the operator is who? That is you, the real you. How many of you have heard the word soul before? You know, Atma. You heard about it. You heard about it? Okay. So, we have two coverings here, as you see here. One gross covering and one subtle covering. Now, what is the connection of this to the stress management? I will tell you. If you know that the yellow one is eternal, permanent, that is the soul is permanent, and the two coverings over the soul, they are actually temporary. They are not permanent. Like the gross body, you all know, you are all small babies, eventually grow into youth, then the body gets old, and then one day you find the body is so old, it is non-functional, then the soul gives up that body, and he accepts another body. Again, another body of a baby again. Or he may be sometimes an animal also, or a bird also, or a tree also. How many of you heard this, what I am saying just now? That the soul can change from one body to another. You heard about it? Yeah, in India people know it quite well. So, now at the time of death, exactly what happens is, the soul comes out of the body along with the subtle body. In the subtle body is stored all your desires in your mind. Like, you know, people, if I ask each of you to write down all your desires, we can make a long list, isn't it? So, to give shape to those desires, the soul goes into another body. To give shape to those desires. Now, what is the significance of this? You go ahead, come here to page number 47 below. I have given mind intelligence tug of war. It's a very important thing. Page 47. So, from there it begins. I have given six case studies I have given. The first case study is page number 48, if you see, giving a seminar presentation. Like our ego says, I am great. I can beat all others. I can give a very, very good presentation. But the mind is saying, oh, I have stage fright. How will I go and present in front of so many people? And the intelligence says, don't worry, we have dozen hours of preparation. You have PPT with you, you are well prepared. Go confidently, intelligence says. But if the mind is strong than your intelligence, then what happens? When you go to give the presentation, you fumble and you lose. On the other hand, if intelligence is strong, you confidently give the presentation and come. So we all have our mind and intelligence. So I have given another skit. If you read this skit, it will become very clear. Mind and intelligence, tug of war. Read that skit on the page number 49. Again, we have Ram Shyam. Read that. When you read this skit, you will understand how important it is for us to, relieve the mind of the stress. Two of you, who two would like to act? Ram Shyam, anybody? Any of you? Okay, two ladies can act also. We will give them chance also. Please. Any two of you? Give the mic to them. Yeah, one is there. One more. Anybody? Yeah, bye. Here is this is a true story. It came in the paper. Based on a true story. Yes? Please go ahead.
why during recession time one Indian named Raja Raman in USA committed suicide?
Alas, Raja Raman, I heard that after studying in UCLA and earning a management degree, went to such great heights of economic development in USA.
You are right, but he suddenly faced recession and money loss. He came down from billionaire to not a beggar, but a middle class man. He cannot face his parents, relatives and friends who had great expectations from him and who might have felt pity about his economic crash.
Shyam, really, he committed suicide?
Not only he committed, he shot his wife and 3 children, 2 daughters and 1 son who were in their teenage. When the neighbors found the house locked for a whole week, he was doubtful and called the police. And the police found what had happened subsequently.
Oh, very bad. Unfortunately, he didn't have a bigger picture of life in which bagging the top rank in an Indian university, studying in USA and becoming an MBA, making billions of dollars, all of that is great. But that is only one of the items of life. True life is much more. Success means to do our best and depend on blessings of God and superiors. If he strengthened his intelligence with wisdom of Gita, his life and his family members would have been saved.
Yes, Shyam. I have also heard that success is not the medals won, but in the race run. When he was subjected to that sudden monetary collapse, he might have felt a great degree of stress, and he didn't know how to cope with it. Thus, not knowing what to do, he shot himself and others.
Therefore, we need to know who we are, what we are living for, and how our education, family, profession, hobbies, finance, all these are different aspects of life we go through. In actuality, we are spiritual beings having a human experience, as one great writer put it.
Yes, Raja Raman found a worldly point of view, studied in the West and achieved success for many years. But everybody finds that life goes through ups and downs. And in this world, Lord Krishna says in chapter 18 of Gita that when you create fire, smoke also accompanies it. Similarly, all endeavors we make will be accomplished by some degree of imperfection. Despite our mind creating a mess, we have to learn to live with the God-given success without becoming frustrated and committing suicide. Why should one give up life just because he had an economic collapse? He had enough to eat his daily bread, a house to live in, and a business to earn his living with grown-up children.
Yes, I appreciate that point. In Gita, Lord Krishna says that one should do his best in this world and leave the rest to God. Besides that, in Bhagavad Gita 15.6, Lord says that one should have a bigger picture of life.
Yeah, up to this, if you see, there are many life lessons we learn. Huh? If you carefully observed, see in the beginning, when he talked about Raja Raman committing suicide, so he says that he didn't crash down coming to the beggar's level, but he became a middle class man. He says that, a middle class man, do you think it's difficult for him to survive in society? He can survive, but what was the reason why Raja Raman committed suicide? Can any of you say? See, he came from this level, not to ground level. He came from this level to, that was the point. He thought that how I was and what am I now? It's like becoming from a billionaire to beggar. So what will society talk of me? He couldn't take it. So which means in our life, we should learn a lesson that, you know, even if something unpleasant happens to us, like when I was in IIT, one boy, in the first 3 years, he was a topper. In the fourth year, he, you know, failed in 2-3 papers. So he entered a lake called Virar in IIT Bombay, and he submerged himself. He just couldn't face his friends and face his parents, correct, no? Then I was thinking, think about Yudhishthira Maharaj, the chief of the Pandavas. Their wife, Draupadi, was insulted in the public. They were driven to the jungle. After 12 years, the kingdom was not given back to them. Is it not true? Bhima was poisoned also. Still, those fellows didn't commit suicide. Isn't it? Because they were always worshipping Krishna. They knew that whatever ups and downs come in life, you have to tolerate it. So therefore you will find here he says that, you know, in page number 50 below, if you see, he says these kind of material successes are all actually only one item of life. True life is much more, he says. Success means to do our best and depend on the blessings of God and superiors. So that is one lesson we learn here. Success in the race and not in the medals one, he says. Another thing he says here, if you see, in the middle of page 51, if you see, you know, we need to know who we are and what we are living for and how our education and all these things are different aspects of life. Actually, we are actually spiritual beings. You are actually Atma, different from the body. In one life, you may be a man. One may be born in West America. Now you may be born in India. The Atma moves from place to place. That one life is like actually like a drama stage in which you play a role. It's like that. Therefore, he's saying, why this fellow foolishly committed suicide? Like that, he's wondering. So another important point is made in page 51 below. In 18th chapter in Gita, Lord Krishna says, when you create fire, there is also smoke. Similarly, all undertakings in this world, the projects, they will be accompanied by some amount of mistakes and defects. You can't avoid it. But just because some mistakes come, one shouldn't become too much bogged up in it. Rather, one should go on with life. Like I've seen when India-Pakistan match, you know, when India wins, our Sachin Tendulkar along with other men looks like a lion, you know. Like that they give a photo. When India loses and Pakistan wins, all these fellows put a towel around their, over their head. And that also where people click the photo and put in newspaper. Isn't it? So in this way, how you take failure and success? So if failure comes, we always can learn some lessons from it and then do it better next time. Like that he's explaining. And go below and then we will not do the rest of the skit, but page number 52 from the middle, if you read further like this, you will get some more valuable lessons you will get. Up to page 54, the skit extends. So, in this way, I have given few case studies there. And come to page 59. See, 59 onwards, it's very helpful for you, that section. From 59 onwards up to page 78. These are all various practical tools to apply in your life. Many things are given. What will cause relaxation to your mind? One interesting thing I'll tell you between this 59 to 78. You remember in the early part of our lecture today, I told you about the tiger, correct? No? The tiger, when it is chasing after the deer or zebra or something, at that time I told you the pupil becomes dilated and the blood goes to the extreme ends of the hands and legs, so he runs very fast and everything I said, correct? And because it is doing that, the stress created in his mind to capture the animal is balanced by all this. Whereas in human life, what happens, I told you example of Sushil. Sushil's boss is a very demanding boss, and Sushil is actually developing some feelings of hatred towards him, but he is not able to take a physical action because human civilization restricts him to, you know, get physical on his boss. Correct, no? But if Sushil goes home and does exercises, that stress will be relieved. Therefore, we should do exercises with the body, like yogasanas. When you do yogasana, PMR we call it, progressive muscle relaxation, is shavasana. If you do shavasana, if you do yogasanas, if you do swimming, there are many relaxation methods are given there in those pages. You can read that. Now I am going to go to page 78. The 12 tips are coming now. I will say briefly about each tip and then you can read it yourself leisurely later. The first one is about expectation. Actually, when we have unrealistic expectations in our life, see, these 12 tips are practically easy to apply, provided you meditate on them, read them and understand them well. So, because the notes is available for you, I am only going to tell you briefly about each and then I will conclude the talk today. First thing is, do not expect that everyone should love you, everybody should be respectful to you, everybody should be fair with you, nobody should cheat you, and I should never commit a mistake. Never think like that. See, are we God that we'll never commit a mistake? Mistakes can happen through us when we are doing things. But when we commit a mistake, when somebody observes us doing a mistake, we look like a fool. So that makes us feel great pain. So these expectations are number one cause of stress in our system. How many of you sitting here are perfectionists? I am one of them, don't worry. Anybody else also here, any more perfectionists? Perfection means he wants to go from 96% to 97%. Perfection. That will take how much energy, you know, to go from 50% to 90%. Almost similar energy is required. Anybody here, you are a little shy to express yourself, or you? Here is one more perfectionist. Satyagopalpo. Anybody else in the audience? You are a perfectionist. Perfectionist means they are adamantly brutal with themselves and with others, making sure that things are done perfectly. Isn't it? Some of them are also smiling in the audience, so I can understand. So, when you are a perfectionist like that, your expectation level is very high from other people. Therefore, I have written in the green if you see a few things. I am always right, I can never commit mistake, and things like that. So, that expectation is number one cause of frustration. So, what we can do, I will tell you. Something practical, I will tell you. Like, I had one assistant traveling with me in the train. So, night he used to keep my laptop with him, and I told him, you have to lock the laptop. It's a very costly one, almost a lakh rupees. So, he would say, okay. So, one day when I saw at 11 o'clock at night, I saw he didn't lock the laptop. He was just keeping it with him. I took away the laptop back from him, and I kept it with myself, and I covered with a blanket. And that fellow got up at midnight, and suddenly he saw it missing. He got down. He went here, there, asking, waking up the people and asking, did anybody see a laptop? You know? And then he came to me. Then I said, I also don't know, I said. I basically wanted to harass him a little bit. And make sure that he takes the matter seriously. And then I scolded him. I said, see, you were sleeping. When I took away the laptop, still you didn't realize. So I told him how careful you should be. From that day on, I told, henceforth, I will carry the laptop. You don't have to carry. So he said, sorry, Prabhu, you are sorry. So 2-3 months I was carrying. So one day I was working in my laptop till about 11 at night. There was some very important work. And then I went to sleep. I was lazy to lock. So I thought that I'll keep it with me and I'll go to sleep. And that fellow somehow took notice of it. So he took the laptop and then he kept it below, the bottom portion he kept it below. And then he pretended to be sleeping. Then when I got up at 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock, suddenly I saw it missing. I thought somebody must have been watching me going to sleep with the laptop they have stolen. So when I got up, that fellow was blinking. And he asked me, Prabhuji, you want something? I said, nothing, go to sleep. I know what I want, I'll find out. Then I went here and there. I told the TT and other people early morning. People said, what is this? You should have been careful. He said, you have been careless, therefore somebody has stolen it. So he came back. At last I had no other resort other than to ask him. I told him, see, somehow due to my tiredness I didn't lock it. Did you see it? Then he smiled and he got down and then he revealed the laptop to me. And then he taught me one lesson. Now he told me, see, I agree that I committed mistake, but now you also committed mistake, you see. To err is human, to forgive is divine, it is said. So in our lives, therefore then I reduced my expectation from other people, expecting too much from others. Because then otherwise I used to throw tantrums like anything before. Now my volume of my tantrums has reduced now. After such experiences, which means even we also can commit mistake, isn't it? So the solution for this is given here in the heading only. Be sensitive to others and be satisfied with God-given things. That means while dealing with other people, be sensitive to them. And in our life, learn to be satisfied without making undue demands. Second thing is about success. How to maintain cool head in success and failure. In India, when India-Pakistan match, India wins, they garland the, you know, all the cricket players, team members. You have seen that? And they take them on a procession also. In the lorry cutout and all they take. And when India loses, they burn the effigies of all the fellows. Same fellows. Is it not funny? One year they praise, another year they burn. That goes to show that the mind of the youths who are doing such activities is like a monkey, uncontrolled. You can see that. So, the second point talks about what is real success. If you go inside, there are two, three very vital points mentioned in that text. That success actually not only means achieving the end result, not only that is success. There are also other things called. For example, do you know how many people write MBA CAT examination for joining MBA? About 1.7, 1.8 people write. 1.8 lakhs people write. Do you know how many get into IIMs? Some 700-800 people only get into IIMs. In case somebody went for a CAT exam and couldn't make it, people ask, your son went for CAT, what happened? And then the father says, oh, he couldn't get through. He couldn't go to IIM. Then immediately the neighbor says, oh, she couldn't, you know, even after writing CAT, he couldn't crack it. That means he must be a fool. They think like that. Can you call him a fool? You see how many vocabs he has memorized. Maybe later he will write GRE and crack it. So we should never think that study is a waste of time. I studied for the competitive exam, it's a waste of time because I couldn't crack it. People think like that. It's a misnomer. You agree? Therefore, it is said, for example, India goes for World Cup. Going for World Cup itself is a very big thing, correct? No? In the same manner, if somebody appeared for some big competitive exam, they studied for it, that is never a loss. The knowledge is never a loss. No? Therefore, I said that statement, success is not in the race run, not in the trophy won, but in the race run, that point we made. So, that is about success. See, I have written below in the success point in red letters. See, just before the red letters, one or two more sentences. After all, what is material success? When we die, we leave behind our degrees, computers, suitcase, home, everything. Like I am Radhesham Das from IIT Bombay. When I leave my body, when I get old and I leave my body, can I carry my IIT degree with me? And next lifetime, I am born in somebody's home as a baby. I come with the IIT degree there. I am IIT Bombay. Can I say that? Isn't it? Yeah, I have to start with Baba Black Sheep again. Back until went up the hill. So then why to worry too much about all these things which you achieved in this life? Why should we allow worry of such perishable commodities that steal our peace of mind, subjecting ourselves to stress? That's the question here. How many of you had experience in your life that you lost something and you are lamenting and you got something better than what you had before? Is it not true? Yeah, you will see that. That means actually God made you lose something so that you can get something better. Otherwise, you would be holding on to it, the previous one. Is it not true? Imagine somebody has a sukha roti, a beggar. If that is removed and he is given a fresh plate of hot food. Similarly, God also may have some other plan for us. So whenever we fail in anything, we should learn some lessons. That's the point. So don't become stressed unnecessarily. If you couldn't, see, my special master used to say always, keep multiple options open. You know, you try this. Okay, this didn't work out, go for something else. You always look for alternatives. Don't be bogged with only one thing. Like one girl who wrote the NEET exam recently, she got 93% in her 12th standard. But in NEET exam, she couldn't crack it. NEET exam is for the medical entrance. She committed suicide by eating some rat poison. It came in the paper just last month only. So we have to teach our children how to face failures with courage. It's very important. Not only jump like a monkey when they get success. When they don't make it, how to face failures with courage. They should learn that also. Then the next one is about C is comparison. This is a very important thing. This also has got to do with inferiority complex. Anybody can say, what is inferiority complex? This is a famous one, it is. Give the mic to her.
Your inferiority complex is when you feel like you are less than the others. Like you focus on whatever weaknesses you have rather than what strengths you might have. And you end up with a low self-esteem.
Very true. Very correct. You feel very much low. You feel I am useless. You feel I am good for nothing. And then if somebody succeeds, your friend succeeds, you feel I am a failure. If your friend fails and you also fail, you feel very good. It's not up. Because after all, you know, such very good friends we are, that both of us together we failed. Like that we feel like that. This is actually called inferiority complex. Inferiority complex arises mainly by comparison. Somebody is inferior to me, I laugh at them, ridicule them. Somebody is better than me, I feel envious of them. This kind of mentality is very dangerous. Duryodhana was like that. When Duryodhana went to Rajasuya Yajna in that Indraprastha, he saw Pandavas are flourishing with so much wealth and gifts and everything, so much respectability and everything. So Duryodhana on the way back told his uncle Shakuni, "My dear uncle, my heart is burning," he said. "I feel like entering fire and committing suicide." Uncle Shakuni asked, "What is the matter, Duryodhana? You can also do such a yajna. You will also get many gifts." Then Duryodhana said, "That's not the point. Uncle, you don't understand. How can a person in this world be happy while seeing his enemies prosper? I want to see the Pandavas wiped out of the surface of the planet," he said. So he was very envious actually. So this leads to envy also, inferiority complex. So one always feels, like one fellow was telling a story that once Lord Shiva gave a benediction to a man, because you worshipped me, whatever you ask, I'll give you. So he said, "I want a two-story building," he said. So Lord Shiva gave him. But then he looked at the neighbor, he had a four-story building. Suddenly how that hut turned into four-story building? Then Shiva said, "You see, he has done double tapasya like you. So whatever you I give you, he will get double." The next time Shiva asked, "What do you want now?" So this fellow said, "Please make my one eye blind," he said. That means what did he want for his friend? Both eyes blind, you see. So people, this kind of envy arises from inferiority complex due to unhealthy comparison. So we get malicious thoughts for others. Is it good? It's very bad actually. That will cause a lot of stress for us when we think ill of others. So animals never compare. You have seen that, like a giraffe is so big, squirrel is so small. They don't compare at all. There is a story in Rigveda when once a squirrel came out of a mountain hole. He heard a loud laughter of somebody. He turned around and saw the mountain was like, swelling like this. Mountain was doing. Then he understood that the mountain is laughing at me. Then the squirrel turned to the mountain and said, "My dear mountain, I do agree that, you have the ability to hold so many forests on your back and you are very big in size. But you may be very big in size, but I am very small in size. You can't be like me. You can't be as small as me. Besides that," he said, "I can crack the nut which you cannot crack," he said. And that was his self-esteem. Because every one of us in this world can do something. Like you look at these five fingers. This finger is used for challenge, isn't it? This finger is used for sambodhan, showing somebody. This finger is used for putting some ring or something. Every finger has some purpose. This finger may think, "Oh, I am the tiniest, I have no use." But sometimes when ears are reaching, you can do like this. People do it. Every finger has some purpose. Is it not true? So no one is useless. That's the point that one should learn here. So the answer to inferiority, if any of us feel inferiority complex, there is one easy solution. Please repeat this. Compare yourself with yourself. That's a solution. That means people who run 100 meter race, they always don't compare with others. They see, "I was running it at 25 seconds. Now I'll make it 22. Now I'll make it 18. So compare yourself with yourself. Run with a stopwatch. Don't run with others. So make comparison of yourself with yourself and you grow in your life. In company also, when you grow, you don't have to worry about others. You worry about how you are doing. You focus on your performance. Then we can rise above that stress arising from unhealthy comparison. And the next one, acknowledge the blessings of God upon you. To begin with, you can think about people who don't have eyes. Some people are blind, some are deaf, some are lame. So think about you have got all the senses of your body perfect. Hands, legs, eyes, ears, everything pakka. So you be grateful to God that He has given you a good body, healthy body. Then think about the education you received. Think about the family in which you are born. You are born in a good family, decent family. There are many children in India who don't get more than one time food in a day. Some beggars, they don't get three days food also they don't get. But we eat three times a day. We have no problem of food. It's arranged. Education, food, everything is arranged. There was a boy who told his father that, "Unless you get me Reebok shoes, I won't go to college." He said, and the father said, I am a poor man, how will I get you such shoes? But the son was very adamant. Later on, the son saw one man was driving this hand-driven cycle. Because his leg was cut up to the knees. And as soon as the boy saw, he had tears in his eyes. He told his father, Papa, I said I won't go to school, college with without Reebok shoes. But this man doesn't have the legs only. At least God has given me legs. Now you give me a Hawaii chappal, I'll wear Hawaii chappal and go to school, he said. He became grateful for what he had. So actually, if you become grateful, your whole mindset will change. Actually, we all in our life should see people who are, in an inferior material position to us. Then we will feel sympathy for them. And we will feel that I am better off materially. For example, think of the underprivileged people. Think of the people who don't get their daily food, who don't have their education. There are some children who are doing child labor to make their earning also. So in this way, you can acknowledge what you have received in your life. Count the blessings of God upon you. See, the Pandavas, I have shown the picture of Arjuna and Krishna. The Pandavas were totally dependent on Krishna at every step. And they knew that whatever we are, see, every one of the Pandavas was very powerful. Arjuna, Yudhishthira Maharaj was very best in javelin throwing. He was a world champion. Similarly, you will see Bhima was very good in mace fighting. Arjuna was very good in archery. Nakula Sahadev, they were very expert in sword fighting. Nakula was also very good in strategy planning. And Sahadev was very good in astrology as well as knowing the animal language also. So they were they were all world champions, but they were never proud. They were always thinking that these are all gifts of God that we possess. Like you imagine, Einstein was the genius of the century. But did Einstein create his own brain? Did he create it? God gave Einstein the brain, correct, no? Similarly, we all, whatever we possess is given, is a gift of God. And count the gifts of God that you have received in your life, then the gratitude will make you always happy. And you will never lament what you don't have. See, the problem is what? Don't look at others what they have. And like one fellow was eating, one young boy was eating 4 puran polis. You know puran poli? Big one. So that boy was just 22 years old. Another fellow was 35 years old. He looked at him and he was feeling very sad. He is eating 4, I am eating only 1. But you know, if your age is going beyond 35, 40, you can't eat 4 puran polis. Very big, big ones. So should you look at others' plate while eating or look at your plate? Yeah? You're doubtful? Yeah, we should look at our plate only. Is it not true? So you count the blessings what God has given you in your life. And look at people who don't have the people below you, economically underprivileged. Then you will always be grateful to God. And the next one is a people's comment, very interesting one. See, this is a very important one. Most important one, I will tell you, amongst all. See, do you know how many hairs you have on your head, if I ask you? We do not know. Only God knows how many hairs we have on each of our heads. Similarly, you don't know all the mechanisms of things happening within your body. That means even about yourself, even you don't know. What do you think other people will know about you? Sometimes a person comes to you and flatters you and praises you, and you also feel very happy because he's praising you more than what you actually deserve sometimes. Your experience? Sometimes they praise you like that. Or somebody insults you, we feel very bad. How can he insult me? See, most people who insult you do not know full picture about you. Say you had a good intention, but they misunderstood you. So when they misunderstand and speak something, you get very hurt. But then at that time, what can you think? Can you tell me? Say one of your colleagues in the office misunderstood you. Say for example, your output in your office goes to your another person. For him, your output is his input. So he tells you, hey, last 1 week I have been telling you, you are simply lazy, you have not done anything. The work is pending. Because of you, I am also not able to start my work. Like that he says. But you know, last 1 week you were knocked down by malaria. Say for example, you are taking medicine and you are at home. Today is the first day you are coming to office and that fellow doesn't know about it. He misunderstands you. How many of you feel? You will feel great stress in your mind because you have been misunderstood by your friend. How many of you feel? You feel stress, yeah. So how will you relieve that stress? So that is what is said here. So you should think in your mind, my poor friend doesn't know what exactly happened to me. If I tell him what happened to me, immediately he will speak differently. You tell your friend, my dear friend, are you not aware? Last 1 week I didn't come to company. You can say like that, isn't it? You didn't come to company. What were you doing? I was knocked down by malaria. I was bedridden for 7 days. Then he will immediately say sorry to you. I'm very sorry. I didn't know this. I was shouting at you not knowing the background. So most people who estimate you, they do not know what you are. And definitely they don't know your intentions, good intentions. Then why to worry about their words seriously? You understand this point? Even we don't know about ourselves fully. Only God knows our conduct, our character, our intentions. He is watching very closely. That is the point here. You know the story of the man and the donkey? I mean, one father and son purchased a donkey in the market. So some people said, hey, you purchased a donkey and you are walking along with the donkey. Why don't you guys sit and go? So they both sat and the donkey carried them. Somebody said, two people sitting on the donkey will collapse. Then the father made the son sit. And then the father was walking and donkey was walking with the son on the back. Some people criticized and told, hey, this young boy is sitting on the donkey. Old man, he is walking. Then he put the father in the donkey and then he was walking. Correct, no? And some people laughed again, saying that, see, they purchased a donkey and the son is unnecessarily walking. Why don't they sit, both of them sit and go? So this fellow was splitting his hair. Therefore, I showed that picture of splitting hair. See here. Isn't it? Then father and son picked up the donkey and threw it over a bridge. They got completely bewildered seeing that. Similarly, you all will see in your life, many people will comment about you. Some people will say, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? They will keep on commenting. So you have to think about whose comments are you going to take seriously. Can you take all people's comments seriously? Yeah, isn't it? See, you all are working to satisfy someone. See, in our life, ultimately, God is the witness of everything. Also your boss in the company to whom you are supposed to report. Correct, no? Similarly, at home, you are supposed to report to mother and father, whatever. So, whomever you have to report, you have to worry about what they are thinking about you. Not the world around you. World around you can talk anything they want. So, you can't worry a damn about it. Yeah. And the next one is, empathize with others. That's an interesting one. See, sometimes a grandfather wants my teenage grandson should sit down and hear Upadesh from me. Do you think bubbling teenagers will sit down and listen? It's very difficult to hold them in one place. Similarly, sometimes a man gets married to a woman who is very dynamic and forceful lady and who is working in an office in a big position. She is a team leader or something. So the man wants her to be very submissive to him. Is it possible? See, can you change the nature of people? Swabhava, we call it. Is it possible to change? So things which cannot be changed, you should not try to expect that they will change. For example, one man was telling, unfortunately, I got a very simple looking wife. See, she looks very simple. But in my office, that lady, people wonder whether she's American girl or Indian girl. She looks so attractive. But I couldn't get such a wife, one man was lamenting. Then he came to know that beautiful girl had a dozen boyfriends. Then he understood, thank God my wife has no other boyfriend other than myself. Except me, she is so chaste. She is a Gunavati. You want a Gunavati or a Rupavati? I asked this question in a college to students. Gunavati means a woman endowed with qualities. Rupavati means one who is very beautiful. So I asked them, do you want a wife like that girl in the office who was extremely beautiful, or you want a wife, the chaste wife? Everybody voted for chaste wife, even if she is not very beautiful. So one boy said, sir, I have a different answer. He said, I asked, what is it? I want Gunavati and Rupavati, both two in one. Of course, somebody may get two in one also. But if one didn't get like that, one should be ready to accept whatever Krishna has sent. Same with wife. For wife also, wife should accept husband as a gift of God. Husband should accept wife as a gift of God also. One has to accept like that. Similarly, some people working in IT company, after working for 5-6 years and completely stressed out, they say, I could have chosen to go in teaching line. I would have been more peaceful. I can sit in my cabin and relax. Here, my boss is behind me. And those who are in teaching, they don't get so much prestige. They say, I should have gone to IT land. You know, my in-laws would have respected me more. Yeah? Like that they think. See, the other side of the mountain is always, that's a problem. If you are here, you think that is better. If you are there, you think this is better. Therefore, here it says, here in this place it is explained that actually, here this see this picture in page 86. The boss is fed up with the incompetent employee. He is yelling at him. So, do you think yelling will make this fellow competent? Any of you imagine you are in this boss's position, what you will do? Will you yell like this? Or what you will do? Alternatively. See, by yelling at him, you are only getting stressed. That fellow, is he stressed? Look at his face. He is very happy. He is an incompetent fool. So what you will do if you are in the boss's position? Yes?
Praise him.
Praise him. So he will do the work by praising. It's a little difficult to praise, no? Not very easy. You have to encourage him. Okay, you can encourage him. What else can you do? Train him. Yes. You can train him, educate him, understand what mistakes he commits, give him support, give him guidance, all those things he can do. Which means you know his swabhava and tolerate. Correct, no? I can take 15 minutes more and conclude this. I'm supposed to finish by 7. I came a little late today by the train. So, and the next one, see, the same point in the red letters it is given. Somebody can read that? In the same heading, empathize with others. That is very important portion. In page 87, in red letters. Read that.
Everyone is born according to their gunas and karmas, their qualities and activities that come from previous lives. To demand them to change to suit their suit your requirement is to ask for impossible. So let people live their own lives. What cannot be cured can be endured.
Yeah, must be endured. So if you endure, you will not be stressed actually. You know who is who. No? Like for example, say some emergency work has to be done. Some emergency work has to be done in a company. They look for the most competent people, correct? No? So you will know whom to give the task. No? In this way, we all have to work with people of different swabhava. Yeah. You have some prasad for them? And the next one is, seeing the sunny side of people. You know what is the meaning of seeing the sunny side of people? See, there is something called ABC mode. You heard about ABC mode? ABC means accusing, blaming, criticizing mode. BMW means blaming, moaning, wailing. So, most people in this world, you know, they criticize their wife, criticize their husband, criticize their children, criticize their office colleagues, criticize their boss. Sometimes they criticize the climate also. Sometimes the government also, they criticize the politicians also. In this way, they criticize and they talk at great length, but they don't gain anything. Therefore, in our life, we should learn to see the sunny side of people. Sunny side means bright side of people. So if you, in those days, the managers used to have a slogan called, catch them doing wrong and give them a red slip. But now they do the opposite. Catch them doing right and give them a yellow slip and appreciate them, like he was rightly saying. By appreciating people, their good qualities increase. By criticizing people, the bad qualities get reinforced. So therefore, we have to see the sunny side. Actually, by criticizing, we become surrounded by a negative cloud. By appreciating, you become surrounded by a positive cloud. So you have the choice in your life. So today onwards, you can begin that every day I'll give 5 compliments. You make up your mind. Whomever I come across. And today onwards, I will be more alert and attentive to see any negative words coming out of my mouth. I will avoid. So like that, one can make a beginning. Yeah. And also one more point is given there, that don't make a mole into a mountain. You know what is making mole into a mountain? Some people commit small mistakes. Don't make a picture of the train journey given. You know why the train journey? Sometimes when you're traveling in a train, say you have a first class ticket, very comfortable journey. Another time, imagine you are going in a sleeper class. You know, the train is a nasty train, heavily crowded, and the wash basin is full of water going like this. And the bathroom doors are open, and somebody has passed stool and it's stinking. Nobody's closing the door again and again, they're keeping it open. And the night you get up, you want to go to washroom, and you find all the people are sleeping everywhere. Now you have to go like a Batman, you know. From the top you have to go. You have seen that? The grown people sleep. So sometimes your train ride is like that. Sometimes you go in the first class or second AC very comfortably. Similarly, our life also is like a train journey. Sometimes comfort, sometimes lack of comfort, sometimes pleasure, sometimes pain. So life is like a train journey. So you will not be stressed if you anticipate that life is like a sinusoidal wave. You know sinusoidal wave? Sine wave. Sometimes up, sometimes down. Both will come. You may get a pat on the back from your boss, or you may get a scolding from the boss also. Both are possible. We should be prepared for it. Then we don't get stressed. We have to tolerate the turn of events. Because our life passes away through these ups and downs like a train journey. And the next topic I've given, right thinking about past, present, future. You see, this is a very important thing. This is the most important thing. Like I told you about the people coming. See, whenever you don't possess anything, you worry about not having it. You've seen that? You worry that, oh, I don't have it. When you get that, then you have fear of losing it. And when you lose it, you lament that you lost it. And when you don't lose it, you are proud that you are possessing it. You understand these four things? Like for example, say, I want to get into IIT. So, I am working hard. I am having a great fear. Maybe I will not get into IIT or something. But at last, when I got into IIT, then what is the next thing people worry, do you know, in IIT? What department I will get? Correct, no? If somebody gets a department which they don't like, they're unhappy again. So, and then in the same manner, oh, if I get this department, it doesn't bring so much pride. I mean, it doesn't produce so much reputation. So our mind always hankers, you will see that. Like one boy had ambition in life that he will marry a very beautiful girl. But after he married her, he was happy that he got to marry her. But the problem was, he said, no other man should look at her. Is it possible in this world to control all the men for him? How difficult it would be. Then he had a fear that she should not divorce and go away with somebody. That was his fear also. And when she did divorce him because of his too much micromanagement, then he was lamenting that he lost her. You understand? No? So that is what is mentioned here in this past, living in the present means. See, all these three have one lesson, one line lesson. If you see page number 90, if you see, below I have given here. Somewhere in the middle. It says that, see, with the right vision, everything belongs to Lord. I also belong to Lord. I am not the owner. I am only a custodian. Like children are like a butterfly, always thrilled because they give the anxieties to parents. Similarly, we can give away the anxieties to God. It says. But then the most important conclusion is this. That Arjuna, what he did, you know that famous verse, Karmanneva Adhikaraste Mahaphaleshu Karachana. Do your duty and hand over your life to God. Like Arjuna gave the ropes of his horses to Krishna. So this is I have a full seminar on this. If you go to YouTube and put Prerana lectures, you can put Prerana, Prerana lectures. In that you put do your best. I don't know whether Rambha Prabhu, do your best directly comes if you put. You have to put Prerana lectures, I think, correct? No? Where in Desertry? In Google, if they put do your best, it will come. And do your best and leave the rest, you put. So that is that lecture if you hear, you will know how to do it. How to do your best and leave the rest. And then the next one, don't regret the past. So that I already gave you some explanation I gave you. And then if you go to page number 92, if you want to avoid regretting the past, this is one thing you should do. God knows best. Repeat. Okay, I'll tell you a little story you will appreciate. One time a man was sleeping in his house, and at about 9 o'clock at night, a brick, you know, got released from the roof, and then it fell on his head. Pat, like that, it came and fell. Started bleeding. He screamed loudly. So the neighbors came, and they immediately picked him up and put him in a car, and they took him to a doctor. He said, no need to go to doctor. He said he was a conjuice. He was a miserly fellow. He didn't want to spend for the doctor. So he said, don't take me to doctor, but they took him. But then the doctor had to apply some anesthesia, you know, and then because it was cut, he had to put a lot of stitches. And then at midnight he woke up. He looked for the doctor and he asked the doctor, "Doctor, tell me how much is the bill?" The doctor said, "It is 2,000 rupees," he said. Then he cried out loudly and said, "Therefore I told my neighbors that don't take me to doctor. I would have put some little bit ointment, something, I would have got well." And then the doctor said, "Just 5 minutes ago I got a news that in the heavy storm your whole roof of your house collapsed. It came down to the ground." And the doctor said, "Now you spend 2,000 rupees, but if you remained at home, what would have happened? You would have become chutney under the roof." Is it not true? So then the doctor told him, "God knows best," he told him. So why he took, you know the story of that fellow who was lying under the tree, you know, he saw the pumpkin. He said, "God created pumpkin on a simple creeper. On the top of this big banyan tree, is creating small fruits. God must be foolish." Like that he was telling. And then when he slept, what happened? One fruit came and fell on his forehead from the top. Small fruit. And that hit him so hard, he jumped up. Then he saw in the mirror, there was a big bump on his forehead. Then he said, "My Lord, imagine if this big fruit was on the top of the tree, my head would have cracked into pieces now." And then he said, "God must be intelligent." So, and then he said, "God knows best." He came to the same conclusion. So when you come to this conclusion in your life, "God knows best," then you will not regret the past. And then don't daydream about the future. Is dreaming wrong? Dreaming is not wrong, but daydreaming is wrong. Daydreaming is useless. Actually, why we should not daydream? You know that story of, here the story is given of that milk vendor lady who was carrying a milk pot. You heard that story? You know, she was dreaming that I will sell this milk, buy more cows, and then, you know, I will become a lady, landlady. I'll only marry a jamindar, she said. And if jamindar doesn't obey me, I will give him a slap, she said. In the course of dream, in the dream, she gave a slap, but then the pot fell down. So all the milk went down the gutter. Similarly, daydream is compared to that. But how can we avoid daydreaming? This requires understanding God is in control. Who is in control? God is in control. And you will see in our life also. See, our life is a two-way phenomenon. You sow the seed, God gives the rain. You give the interview, and the panel chooses you. The student writes the exam, and the invigilators and others correct the papers and give the marks. Is it not true? Is it one way or two way life? It's way, like your endeavor and God's grace. Both have to be combined. Therefore, if you have done your endeavor, then leave it to God. So then if you do that, then you will not daydream. Okay, I have done my part. Now whatever God wants to do, let him do. And the next one is ego. We have to give up the false ego. What is it? I was the first one to do this. Some people say like that. Nobody else can do it without me. I am indispensable in this project. If I pull out from this project, everything will collapse. Like that, some people speak like that. What is this? Ego. That ego has to be given up, because you see, we are all like Arjuna and Krishna in the chariot. If you see, Arjuna is fighting the battle, and who is riding the chariot? Krishna riding. In our life also, we all are endeavoring, but God is giving us buddhi. So we should give some credit to God also. That is the point. And then stress to impress. In page number 96 below, modern day society is a society where everybody wants to impress others. So one time Akbar took Tanzan with him to meet Mirabai. Mirabai was doing kirtan. And Akbar had tears in his eyes hearing the devotional music. Later on, Akbar asked Tanzan, "Hey Tanzan, when you sing, I don't cry tears. When I heard her sing, I had tears welling up in my eyes with so much of bhakti bhava. Why is it so?" And then you know what Tanzan said? He said, "Sir, she sings for the Lord, but I sing for you," he said. She sings for the Lord without any expectation. So therefore, in this world, if we do activities to impress others, no, other people will become envious of you, and your heart will be a kokla, hollow, empty, it is said. But actually, this stress to impress, you know, seeing glamour, showing glamour is a very big thing in this world. Everybody is more, I heard one interesting statement, people purchase things which they don't need with money which they don't own to impress people whom they don't like, they said. So what is the money that you don't own? Credit card. Correct, no? And who are the people whom you don't like? The people whom you envy you. Therefore, they say, you know, neighbor's envy, owner's pride, they say, no? So in this way, people in this world become envious when we try to impress others. So then what to do? You do your work properly, and don't get into the impressing game. Impressing game causes tremendous stress. Most of the people who get heart attack and BP rise and all that, they all have been people who have been trying to impress others in a big way. And even in dreams, they are thinking of themselves becoming very big. Huh? I will be like, kuch karke dikhana hai. You can have ambition, but you cannot have over ambition. You see, just like Luna, Maruti and Benz have different speeds. Similarly, our body, intelligence, everything has certain limits also, beyond which you cannot operate. Like some people are naturally born beautiful. Do you agree? Some people put a lot of fair and lovely and they go to the beauty parlor. Little beauty they can increase, but they cannot be like the naturally beautiful people. Do you agree? Similarly, there are people who are extraordinarily intelligent. In IIT, we used to have 4 boards, you know, green boards. So Professor Maiti used to write finite element modeling mathematical problems, you know. First board, everybody would be raising hand and giving answers. Second board, third board. When he goes to third board, only one or two hands will be up. Because most boys won't understand what is going on. Because he has written a lot. So some people are extraordinarily intelligent. Undeniable fact. Therefore, in this world, we have to do our best and leave it to God ultimately. Nowadays, even tuition centers tell, should you try for IIT or NIT or other engineering college and other things. Do you know that? What do they call it? Mock test, they call it. Correct, no? They give it. So once you give the mark test, be peaceful. Wherever one can get in. Similarly, Ivy League universities in the West, and everybody cannot get in there. So one doesn't have to commit suicide, but just because I couldn't get into Ivy League university. So therefore, he is saying, don't try to impress. And the last one, yeah, sublimate desires, not express or suppress. Yeah, see that picture in the page 99. See that fellow is a greedy fellow. If you express all your desires, this fellow appears he is going to burn out of greed. And similarly, if you suppress, suppressing also doesn't help. But we should be like Ambarish Maharaj, example is given. What should we do with our desires? You can divide your desires into 3. Those desires which are perfectly given in the scriptures, which are right things to do in life. You can aspire for them. And there are secondly the desires which are pleasurable, which are not prohibited. They are pleasurable for you. Thirdly, there are prohibited desires. You know prohibited? Yeah. You can give them prasadam also. Prohibited means nishiddha. One should not do those things. For example, meat eating, gambling, intoxication, illicit sex. These are prohibited. Then there are pleasurable things, like you may play cricket. It is not connected to God, but it's a pleasurable activity. So one may watch TV or such kinds of things. And prescribed things means, like for example, rising in the morning, chanting God's names, bowing down before God, studying Bhagavad Gita. These are all prescribed in the scriptures. So our desires can be refined, made purer. Lower desires can be nullified. Higher desires can be utilized. So you can read that later on. That's all. After that, the rest of the book you can read yourself. I will show you one interesting thing. Page number 110 you can go. Page 110. See, in page 110 there is one picture, you are seeing it. See, the brainwave frequency is shown. Below 3, it is sleepy zone. Below, between 3 to 8 also, drowsiness zone also. Above 13, it is active and then later on hyperactive. So passion increases beyond 13 and laziness increases below 8. You understand, no? But we do a meditation called as Hare Krishna Mantra meditation. By chanting that meditation, you are going to post yourself between 8 to 13. See, that zone is called a relaxed alert zone. Relaxed alert zone. You are very peacefully relaxed and you are very attentive also, simultaneously. So there is a Harvard research on this. mantra chant, which is given in page 111. It's given. So you go to page 112 below. In the brown color box, I have given the Maha Mantra. So that is the mantra. Please repeat. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. See, man means mind, tra means that which liberates. So mantra means that which frees the mind. It gives freedom to the mind. That means where is the stress situated? In the mind. But by chanting mantra, it is relieved. So page 113 onwards, I have given very valuable tips. Leisurely you can read multiple tips. Appendix 2 is very special, page 117. Not appendix 2, appendix 2 is alright. Appendix 3 is very, very special, not 2. Page 120. If you see, on each of these topics, healthy stress, art of overcoming worry, doing too much and all that, each of it I have elaborated in bullet points. They are all given point wise. And I would say amongst all the appendices, appendix 3 is very important for you. They are all given like point wise, you can read it leisurely. So now, many important parts of the book I have covered today for you. So, in summary, I will tell you what I told today. I told you about difference between threat and threat percept. You all are confident about it. You understood well with all the examples. Then I told you about the paradigm of the body and the mind. They all have limits. And stress means we are overworking the body or overloading the mind with stress. Then I told you about the working place, what all different types of situations like deadline, driven projects and other things we said, which lead to stress. Then another thing we did was, we did certain activities to learn not to be an overreactor. We can react, but not overreact. It's not good. Overreaction increases stress. If somebody becomes extremely angry or extremely fearful or extremely greedy, these things cause stress and the adrenaline secretes causing problems. So that we learned. Many of you gave wonderful solutions to how we can tackle such situations. Especially nowadays in modern times, we need a lot of patience and tolerance nowadays. That's one thing we learned. Then a couple of dramas we learned also. How to face failures with courage. That was one drama we learned. Another drama we learned about not to assume about people things. We should actually always give a benefit of doubt while dealing with people. That we learned also. And then we learned to escape stress. So E for expectations, not have too much expectations about ourselves and others. And S for success definition, C for comparison, and A for acknowledging acknowledging God's blessings, yeah, correct. CA. And P for people's comments, isn't it? And E for empathize with other people by knowing the swabhava in advance. Learn to live with people of different swabhava. Especially in your life, you will see you only have single digit number of people who are very close to you. Say in your family, say husband, wife, children, mother, father. And colleagues also, maybe 2, 3, 4 colleagues. With these people, if you can tolerate them, you will conquer the whole world only. Because these are people every day you talk to them. They are all around you. So learn to empathize with their swabhava at least. So this is escape. And stress. Similarly, there are other letters. So, leisurely go through it yourself when you get time. And chanting of Hare Krishna is extremely helpful. It is very soothing to mind and very calming to mind. And you develop inner willpower and strength by chanting Hare Krishna in order to face the external world, which is ruthless world nowadays. People sometimes insult you. Many people don't have proper character. Many companies are hiring and firing people. They don't protect their employees. And deadline-driven projects are increasing. And many companies are removing many employees and asking one employee to do the work of 5 employees. They are doing that. And so then, therefore, in modern times, this topic is even more relevant. So you read this book at your leisure and grasp other places which I didn't cover it today. I think we have covered a good amount of knowledge from this book today. So this program we have been holding here once in a month or so. We did two debates. We started with one debate on live-in relationship or marry. So we had one debate, 33 people had come. Then second debate we had on, did we come from branches to benches? Did we come from branches to benches? That means, were we apes before? And then from apes, humans came. So Darwin's theory versus creationist. So we did that also debate last time we did. And this is the third program on stress to smile. And I'm thinking of doing one more booklet I have called Art of Smart Work, which I thought of doing next time. In case we do Art of Smart Work in future, how many of you think you would like to come? You may be interested. A good amount of them. Okay, I have a booklet like this. There are also activities there. So I can do it. Coming Sunday, I'm coming again. Actually, the same timing, 5 to 7, coming Sunday. If you keep Art, you have the book with you, Art of Smart Work, one copy. You have a copy of the book? So we have a similar size book, small pocket book. And that book will also help you to learn seven different ways how to work smarter, not harder. That book will teach you. Okay, I'll do it coming Sunday. Same place, Mataji, you can do. Okay, so thank you very much.
Hello, I am Vinita Linga. I work in Equity Technology. I'm a part of your group, Parivar Students.
Hello, I am Ashok. I'm working in Untapped Technologies Private Limited. How are you? From the ISKCON Temple.
Come on, you can't do that.
Yes.
The talk is on.
Hello, my name is Ashok.
Course in my college, PICP.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm listening to for the course of
sitting?
Yes, I was.
Okay, you're working with one?
I am working with Android.
Where are you living?
I am living near passport office. Okay. So, one of my colleagues.
What's your name?
My name is Ankit.
Okay. I came for your discovery, I suppose.
Yeah, discovery yourself in my college.
Okay. I am returning to the place.
I used to regularly come to the college center near the college. After that, connection was lost.
Even yesterday.
Yeah.
Very happy. You know, we have such a test.
My name is Tejas. I am a student. I came to know through my friend.
You are studying where, Tejas?
Whatever.
Hello everyone, you are one of the body college friends last time we came, two of them came.
Hello,
you are me. So you came last time, yeah.
So,
oh, you are not you came last time.
Yes,
he has
entered the
last time. Okay, very good, very strong.
Hello everyone, my name is Raviraj. I study at MIT College in Lonely Kanpur and I study in Web.
So you are married in here?
No, no, I study engineering, civil engineering, the B.Tech course.